Good morning. Good morning. It's so good to see you this morning. Would you join me in beginning our service, a wonderful song to sing, God of the Ages, if you'll stand and sing with me. Would you pray with me? Lord God, we offer you this time, this service, our music, our words and thoughts, our prayers. May all that we do build the strength and relationship between us and draw us closer to you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Would you make one another feel welcome in this house of the Lord? You are happy and wide awake today, I can tell. And I'm very glad to have Jen Hoffman up here to help lead us in worship this morning.
Good morning. Please stand and join me in the call to worship. Lord God, you have been our true home forever. Long before the mountains were born, long before you brought earth itself to birth, from once upon a time to kingdom come, you are God. 1,000 years in your sight are like yesterday when it is past, or like a few hours in the night. Teach us to count our days so we may gain a wise heart. Fill us full every morning with your faithful love so we can rejoice and celebrate our whole life long.
Gratefully sing.
please be seated and join me in the opening prayer. O holy God, you faithfully keep the promise you made to our ancestors. You lead us into the future, providing care and guidance on the way. As we travel this journey of faith, may we truly be Jesus' disciples, following and pursuing the path of love and generosity in all things. Thank you for your presence and power that strengthens us and makes us whole. In Christ's name, amen.
Church. Yeah, it's that long ago. There was virtually no music written for handbells. What we did was we played standard hymns or piano music or sometimes organ music, or once in a while we wrote our own stuff. In 1969, the national organization was beginning to become strong, and one of its proponents was Don Alured, who was the minister of music at First Methodist Church in Lake Charles, Louisiana. He wrote an article entitled, "Quit Ringing Ding Dong Music." His whole idea was, a set of bells is not anywhere different than a harp. You have about 60 different pitches, and each one of them would be like a string on a harp. So if you write music for a harp, why don't you write music for an instrument, the bells? So in 72, Don penned this particular piece. It was designed to teach those of us who are out here what handbells could really do. So here's a piece from 1972, which he thought showed what an instrument could do. Now, you won't hear any malleted pieces, you won't hear martellos, you won't hear any shakes, you won't hear any of those things that have happened in the last 15 years. This is pure and simple, an instrument.
Thank you.
Would you join me as we sing together, My Country 'Tis of Thee? Would you stand? Stand up. And thank you to the Bells for accompanying us.
The first of three scripture readings today comes from Luke 19, verses 1 through 10. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was wealthy. He wanted to see who Jesus was, but because he was short, he could not see over the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and said to him, "Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today." So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and began to mutter, "He has gone to be the guest of a sinner." But Zacchaeus stood up and said to Jesus, "Look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor, and if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount." Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, because this man too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost." The next reading comes from Mark 12, 41 through 44. Jesus sat across from the collection box for the temple treasury and observed how the crowd gave their money. Many rich people were throwing in lots of money. One poor widow came forward and put in two small copper coins worth a penny. Jesus called his disciples to him and said, "I assure you that this poor widow has put in more than everyone who's been putting money in the treasury. All of them are giving out of their spare change, but she, from her hopeless poverty, has given everything she had, even when what she needed to live on." And the last reading comes from Proverbs 11, 24 through 25. "Those who give generously receive more, but those who are stingy with what is appropriate will grow needy. Generous persons will prosper. Those who refresh others will themselves be refreshed." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Jen is doing double duty today. She signed up months ago to be liturgist, and then John recruited her to sing with him today. This is a song I came across a few weeks ago and sent it over to John, and it's beautiful for this day of dedicating our gifts.
Mm-hmm.
It is really fun as a pastor to get an idea and have somebody else fulfill it. It's wonderful. Thanks to both of you. Would you pray with me and for me? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts always be acceptable in your sight, O God, for you are our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. So for the past 3 weeks, we've been talking about some very practical advice from the founder of the Methodist movement, John Wesley. The interesting thing is that we're finding it very applicable for today even though when he first taught it, it was somewhere around 1745. So it tells us something about money and dealing with it and the Christian life, that there are things that have not changed much in our own walk of faith. But John Wesley's rules for dealing with money were very simple. He said, earn all that you can, save all that you can, then give all that you can. Pretty straightforward. It was refreshing for some of us to hear the earn all you can, that we were not supposed to live in poverty to prove our deep and abiding faith, that John Wesley saw, just as we do, that money is how we make a difference in the world. And without money, we can't, as individuals or as a group, affect the world around us. So Wesley taught, and we still believe, that earning and saving money are not the end of the story. Earning and saving are towards the purpose of generosity, toward the purpose of giving. Giving is the heart and the purpose of having money. It impacts all of our lives, and it allows us to impact the world around us. Now, this is the time of year that when, and you can groan now if you want, when we make a pitch for you to give money to the church. So we're doing the straightforward part first. What is most helpful to us as a church is if you are willing to make a pledge to give a specific amount each week or each month throughout the year. That helps with the church budget and budgeting and planning. Also, you may want to know or not want to know, but the reality is it takes $640,000 a year for us to run the church with the building, the programs, the staff, all that we do. In addition to that, it's $165,000 a year that we're paying on our stupid mortgage. You can tell how I feel about that mortgage. It sounds overwhelming when I sit down to fill out my own card. But it is amazing to me that together we are accomplishing so much, so much. None of us could do alone what all of us can do together. But the reality is, we don't give because we want to underwrite a budget. We don't give to be a line item on a piece of paper. I think that really what we give to is the mission of the church and the purpose of the church. And our purpose is to provide a place where we can worship God and where we can encourage each other as we follow Jesus Christ with our whole hearts and in every aspect of our lives. That is worth giving to. We give because we are a church that genuinely and honestly tries to welcome all people from all walks of life without exception, and I cannot tell you how rare that is in our world. A genuinely open welcome. That's worth giving to. We give because as a church we nurture ourselves and each other, and we nurture our kids and our young people in their faith, all of us together learning and serving and being in fellowship. We give because we serve people in need. It's one of our heartfelt missions and desires as a church to increasingly outreach to the community and the world around us. Community, spirituality, service. That's what we're giving to. We don't give to fulfill a budget. We give to fulfill a purpose. So about this time last year, you heard me give a rather sober accounting of church finances because this has been a challenging time for our church, and primarily because for a number of years, we balanced our budget on the back of our savings. And it was great while we had lots of savings. But we've depleted the savings to a place where we can't go any lower and feel secure. And with our savings depleted, I insisted and made some people very angry with me, but I insisted that we try to form a budget that is actually in line with our income. A balanced, yeah, novel idea. Jen's laughing back here. It's sort of like you have to do with your own finances, right? But in order to do that, we had to cut out some considerable amounts of money, and you can't cut out the costs of the building. Those are pretty well set. And the only other big place to cut is in staff. And so in this last year, we have not had a paid parish visitor, as the church has had for many years, and we no longer have an associate pastor. But we're an awful lot closer to having our income be in line with our expenses. And so now, we start from a solid financial foundation to grow. It's been a lot of work, and I can say thank God for volunteers, because there is so much that would not have happened here in this year if many of you had not stepped up to do it. That said, I dream of a day when we can have an associate pastor again. And mainly because it hurts my heart that I cannot always be with each one of you when I should be with you. At times of transition in your life, at times of simply loneliness or times of recovery from illness, I try my best, and generally I think I do a good job of being with you at moments of true crisis, at moments of real crisis. What hurts my heart is that I'm not with you visiting in your homes or spending time with you in your fellowship groups, and it's just not possible. I pray that we're growing back to the point where we have an associate pastor, because two pastors are needed, honestly, for this size of congregation. And between us, we could offer pastoral care and concern and support everywhere that it's needed, not just in the ultimate crises. So, I have seriously increased my giving for 2016. It's going to adjust some of the way I live and some of the way I make choices with my money. And I can tell you outright that I would willingly take a pay cut if it meant that we got to have an associate pastor again. But that's probably a year or two off. I just want you to know where the church is, where I am, and where we are headed together, because your giving is amazing. At the time that this church took on a mortgage, it did not reduce its operating budget in order to account for the payments that were going to be made towards the mortgage. We were just hoping that $200,000 a year would magically appear, which of course it did not. But I am praying and working, and I hope you're pulling with me towards the day when the mortgage does not determine the ministry we can do, when that money is redirected to outreach and caring and growth within and outside the church. So that's the speech about giving to the church. And you have a pledge card in your bulletin just in case you forgot to bring yours from home. Like, isn't that nice of us to give those to you? We invite you during the offering time to drop those pledge cards into the offering basket. And even if you are not able to pledge a specific amount at this time, we would like to have a card back from you that simply says, "I'll give as able," on it, because that lets us know that you have thought about it and prayed about it and that you are, this is your response to the church. And we appreciate that very, very much. And it also means that you don't get any follow-up letters or phone calls, which I know is motivation enough to put your pledge card in and say, we'll give as able. Okay, so that said, that's the practicalities of it. And today in our scriptures, we're told very clearly that really, our giving and our generosity isn't about budgets and giving cards. It's about our heart and our spirit. Jesus, in his stories, tells us that true generosity isn't measured so much by how much we give, the amount that we give. True generosity isn't even measured by how much difference our giving makes to somebody else. Real generosity is measured by how much our giving affects us. How much our giving changes us. And how much our generosity shapes our lives and our values and our souls. The scripture verse in Proverbs said simply, those who refresh others will themselves be refreshed. And giving, being generous, brightens and refreshes our souls. I'm convinced of it. And the two stories we have from Luke and Mark. First from Mark, some of you grew up probably knowing this story as the widow's mite. Meaning a small coin. We call it the widow's offering, maybe. And Jesus is sitting there in the temple, watching people come up and drop coins in the offering box for the temple. And many well-to-do people drop in pretty significant offerings, and you can imagine many heavy coins being dropped in. And then one woman, who is obviously poor, drops in two very small coins. We're told they might add up to a penny in our time. And Jesus comments to his disciples and to all the people around him. He says, this woman has given the greater offering. The wealthy gave money they'll never even miss. But this woman has given everything that she has. Now, in light of John Wesley's instructions to earn and save all we can and to be responsible about our money and caring for our families, I could just hear him saying, now that's not being very wise to give all that you have and leave nothing to live on. But Jesus was looking at the spiritual impact of her gift, that this woman loved God so deeply and trusted God so much, she was moved to give everything she had. Giving money that doesn't change or affect our lifestyle or our financial choices isn't really giving in a way that's going to impact us spiritually. It's not the size of the gift, it's the impact on the giver. And if you want to look at impact on the giver, you have to talk about this story of Zacchaeus in the Gospel of Luke. Many of you, like me, may remember the children's song from Sunday school. Zacchaeus was a wee little man, and a wee little man was he. And he climbed up in a sycamore tree because the Lord he wanted to see. See, but that's kind of where the story ended for us as children. Or maybe we remember that Jesus did indeed come by and tell Zacchaeus that he was going to his house that day. But the really important part of the story for us as adults isn't the tree climbing or the Jesus just going over for dinner. It's Zacchaeus' response. It's the end of the story. Zacchaeus was a man who was so transformed by his encounter with Jesus that he totally repented and confessed about his abuse of power as a tax collector, about his stealing from innocent people as he took their money for taxes. And not only did he confess and repent, he promised to make restitution. And get this, he said that he would pay anyone back that he had cheated, that he had stolen from, he would pay them back four times the amount he had stolen. And then he would give half of all the rest that he had to the poor. Now that's an impact. That's an impact when you think that Zacchaeus is giving up wealth, he's given up his social status, and he probably has even given up his job. All because Jesus met him with grace. Jesus met him with grace and love and acceptance and forgiveness. Everybody else around was grumbling and griping that Jesus was going to go eat in this sinner's house. And the result is that Zacchaeus' finances, and even more importantly, his entire life, is completely transformed. Jesus' presence in our lives is an incredibly powerful thing, too. There's a passage from, I think it's 2 Timothy, that has always spoken to me. It says, once you were no people, but now you are God's people. Once you were no people, but now you are Christ's people. A dramatic transformation of our life and our souls, our attitudes and our values. God's grace and acceptance and forgiveness makes all the difference in our lives. It makes all the difference in how we see ourselves. It makes all the difference in how we're able to love others. It makes all the difference in our path to eternal life. And so our generosity and our giving should make a difference in our lives too. It really should. The true measure of our generosity is not found in the dollar amount that we give. It's in the difference it makes in our heart and in our soul and in our life. Does your giving make a difference to you, in you, for you? That's the question for today and for always, between you and God. Amen.
Creator, giver of all things, accept my humble offerings, because all I have is yours. When I was chained to greed and pride, tight-fisted and destined to die, you paid my debt and bought my life, and all I have is yours. This offering is a means of grace. You show me this to grow my faith. The more I give, the less I need. I learn that you'll provide for me. I was blind to this, but now I see. Generous, gracious God, with these gifts and these promises, may we grow in your light and thrive in your grace. Amen. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ make us gracious to others. May the Lord of our God and may the fellowship and strength of the Holy Spirit fill and empower us.
Until we show in our own lives
the very spirit and character of Jesus, our Savior. Amen.